Hey, hey, this is director, producer Alan Wills, and I am on Positive Power 21 with Jerry Royce Live. And when I'm online, I listen to Jerry Royce Live at www.spreaker.com/positivepower21.org. Y'all heard?
Hi, this is Pastor LaTarsha Holden. I am of I'm Free to Be Me, and I'm here on Jerry Royce Live, PositivePower21.org.
You are listening to PositivePower21.org with Jerry Royce.
What up? It's your boy Kano Kingston.
Hi, this is Angel Sessions.
Hey, this is Pat.
Hi, I'm Teresa Powell.
Hi, Jerry. This is Iowa Sandra Carter.
Hi, this is Phil Powers.
Hello, this is Teresa Barbie with Jerry Royce Live.
Hi, I'm Philip Barron. I'm live on the Jerry Royce Show.
Hey, what do you do? This is Boy Who's the Say.
Hey, this is Dolly, the poet, spoken word artist.
Hello, this is Lamar Marquis with Jerry Royce Live.
All right, everyone. We got Robin Lynn, and I'm keeping it live right now on Jerry Royce Live.
Hey, what's going on, everybody? What's up? This is award-winning podcast with the greatest podcast on earth. Thank you for stopping by. I'm your host, Jerry Royce Live Worldwide on Internet Radio, where you get your positive on. So when it's all positive, it's all power. That's positive power. This is a worldwide podcast for growth, wealth, and success. Thank you. A poetry book written by Philip Beery, testimonial of one's true greatness. Without the touching and compelling healing story, one wouldn't be able to tell the grace and the goodness of God's ultimate and testimonial glory. These stories and the uplifting messages behind the concept and the meaning of this book is mostly about overcoming tough challenges, obstacles, and giving God all the well-deserved glory and the highest praise. This book is available on Amazon.com in digital and hard copy, and you can find it at Infinity Publishing at buybooksontheweb.com. Testimonial of One's True Greatness by poet Philip Beery.
Hey everyone, don't forget about Tea Time Thursdays with Jerry Royce Live Worldwide on PositivePower21.org.
You are listening to Jerry Royce Live Worldwide Podcast.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you for joining us, and welcome to PositivePower21.org. Can you feel the power? Can you feel the power 21? The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I am Jerry Royce Live. I am blessed. I am worldwide. And Philippians 4:6 reads,
Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God your needs, and don't forget to thank him for his answer. You're listening to episode 395. Tonight on the show, we have Pastor Latasha Holden. She has a book I call I'm Free to Be Me. It's available in Kindle edition on Amazon.com. And her bio reads, Pastor Latasha Holden is a native of Atlanta, Georgia. She was walking statistics, high school dropout, four kids by the age of 22, welfare recipient, low self-esteem, mentally, verbally, physically abused. The predictable outcome was a life of poverty, dependency on welfare, uneducated and underemployed with a little chance of success. Her book, I Am Free to Be Me, is a book that will give you hope, inspire many to keep pushing despite the odds. If you're tired and you feel like you can't go any further, this is a must read. It will help you, encourage you to keep going, keep pressing, and not look back. Read about the countless obstacles and the odds that were against this single mother and how she overcame them with persistence and perseverance. I'm Free to Be Me will stir up and motivate you to push you toward the finish line. Woo! Latasha. Pastor Latasha Holden, welcome to Positive Power 21.0. How you doing tonight?
I am doing well, and thank you for having me.
Oh, my pleasure, and thank you for joining us right here. We're so excited to have you. I was just talking about that Kimberly Kim. Is that what they call her? Kimmy Kim. Now introducing the – I saw your Facebook page. I said, oh, my God, we got to have her on the show. Pastor Holden, you're a beautiful young lady, and it looked like you have done well for yourself, you know, despite the odds that was against you, and we're just so happy to bring you so my audience can hear your testimony. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
All right. So the first question is, who is Pastor Latasha Holden?
Well, I guess to say that I'm someone that God didn't give up on. You know, when you make mistakes in your years, you're more, you know, became more like the black sheep of the family. So as you read, I am a native of Atlanta, Georgia, and the oldest of three girls. I have three sisters, and I'm just here trying to do what God called me to do, Jerry, and that is to his and give hope to his people.
Yeah. And how you doing that? Through your writing, through your pastoring, through your touch, what you doing?
Yeah.
How you helping people?
I mean, through writing, speaking, preaching. When I speak or preach, my personal ministry is mercy and grace and the love of Jesus. I'm real big on that because he gave it to me. You know, I think sometimes I still sit in shock and amazement because Jerry, he brought me a long way. I mean, I was literally counted out. I was counted out, you know, I mean, I had a lot of going against me, but I just think in the last 8 years, he just, wow, my life just went into this spiral and to who I am today. So I just thank him that he didn't give up on me when everybody else did.
Yeah. Now I've heard your story, you know, countless times on Relations Radio. You know, we picked them up on Positive Power 21.org. And I thought it was an incredible story. I was like, wow, who is she talking to? And, you know, you mentioned, you know, four kids by the age of 22, then two more homeless. How did you survive with six children? Some people can't even deal with themselves and perhaps a raggedy girlfriend or boyfriend tagging along. How did you do that?
Now, that's how I know God was with me. To be honest with you, that probably was the hardest thing because at the time, you got to think, you're talking about uneducated. I had a GED. I dropped out in 10th grade. Didn't have no employment history. And I really was beat down. I mean, I just thought I was a loser. So that was a hard task. But I knew, like I tell people, I just vowed to myself that I had to protect my children. I think they became a strength for me to where I had to keep going. But at the same time, I was more focused on raising children They would not embarrass me. They would not embarrass themselves. No matter what predicament we was in, I knew that if I didn't have anything to give them materially, that I can love them unconditionally. And that's what I did. Yeah. And so,
were you guys living in and out of, were you living inside of shelters or, you know, automobiles? What was the deal with your living conditions?
When I enrolled in college, we were living in a boarded up home that was foreclosed. I guess now I'm learning that we were squatters. I didn't know that then. And and so we lived in shelter, car, scraped up money for hotels, friends, family. So that went on for about 2 years in my beginning of my undergraduate years, and it took a lot.
You didn't have a home when you were in college?
No, when I enrolled in college, we was homeless. We were living in a boarded up home.
So how you get away with that? Normally you have to give them your address and everything to enroll. So how you get away with that?
I know. It was this guy I met, and he just, I don't know. I think he was overseeing the house with somebody. And maybe he gave me a bogus lease so I can go get him. I didn't know. I just know the house was boarded up. It stayed boarded up for a while until the fire department rolled by. And they saw us sit on the porch, and they said, "Man, you live there?" I was a little scared. I said, "Yes." He said, "Man, you can't live in that house with those boards up to those windows." Mm. But that's what we had, you know, so we took them down. And I'd be lying. Man, I was scared. I mean, I to go through homeless with no family support, I mean, it's like the joke was on me. Let's watch her do this. And it was time for suicide. I was depressed. I was embarrassed that I was the mother of the kid. You know, it was a lot.
Mm-hmm. So what were the ages of your kids when you were in undergrad?
Okay, we say 8 years ago. The oldest now, he's 26. So I got four grown kids now. So I think everybody was like maybe 17, 15, 13, 12, and maybe 5 and 4.
Oh, wow. Okay, so you had the two little ones that you really had to care about. So the teens kind of was, so they were with you, but they were kind of feeling for themselves too, like in survival mode. So, hey, we got, so they were in school, right? So they were in school, like junior high school and high school, right?
Yeah. But to them, that was the most embarrassing times of their life, you know, because we didn't have, it was sent to them. So we really struggled materially. You know, we didn't have the stuff to, I guess, the average family probably have, you know, they couldn't, you know, to them, you know, they couldn't wear the decent clothing. I mean, they wouldn't hold it, but then we moved around a lot, you know, and so.
I got a big question. Now, you know, I worked with the health department for a couple of years in the lead abatement program, and we had a lot of young ladies who, you know, had 2, 3, 4 kids, but they were, you know, in those housing programs, you know, where they paid like $50 a month, and they had really nice apartments, you know.
Yeah.
So most of the time it wasn't in the hood. They were nice areas of, you know, county. So you didn't qualify for housing?
You know what? I had my name on Section 8 waiting list for 14 years. Nothing came available. I say I was, it's like God had every door. But see, I wasn't raised in a church, so I looked at it as my wilderness experience. This is where me and God got to know each other. This is where I had to learn how to fight. I'm a peacemaker by nature, but I had to learn how to fight during these last 8 years. I had to learn how to persevere. Because I didn't have no structure in my life. Come on, I dropped out in 10th grade, so I was used to giving up. But the last 8 years, I had to kind of learn how to become a strong person within, you know. And
So with 6 kids, nobody pushed you to the front of the list? Nobody? They didn't have a place for you to bunk? No temporary housing? Nothing?
Nothing. We went to the shelter for about 2 months. And that was it. My you know, families might, you know, we did stay with family here and there. I even remember a couple of times, I'm not gonna call names, 2 relatives. I asked one time, one of them, look, can we just lay on the floor? Can we just, and she said no. I said, okay. And then I even asked a family, can they just give me money for one hotel for one night? That's it. And they said no. I was like, okay.
Wow. So you guys had to travel with all your personal things with you everywhere you went until you found the board up home?
Yeah.
No running water, I guess. So yeah, no running water, I imagine.
Well, the guy, when he gave a boat, you know, the lease helped us get the lights and water on, you know. But it was vacant. I don't, like I said, I think he was overlooking the property. He didn't have the go-ahead from the people who owned the house.
Right.
But I think you, as a squatter, which I'm learning, that's what we were, you know. But, right. So that was.
Okay, so he did provide you guys with electricity and water. So a guy did kind of help you out, even though it wasn't his property.
And yes.
It was technically supposed to be vacant. He let you stay there with the kids. So how long you guys stay there?
3 months.
3 months. And then you moved on to where? And you're in school now, so you had to move on.
Yeah, and you know, that's how I know God was with us, because I really don't even know how we got from place to place that tree. I just know we ended up in a shelter for 2 months, that house for 3 months, maybe on our car for 2 or 3 days, maybe somebody scraped up hotel money for another 2, and it just went on and on. Maybe a friend, you know, maybe with family for 2 or 3 months, and it just, but that was a hard time.
But while all that was happening, you were still staying strong for the kids. So did the kids ever see you break? Did they ever see you at your point where they had to comfort you?
Well, you know what? They saw me. I mean, I was I remember one time my son in the Marines, he was in his senior year. And I just asked him, because when he graduated, because there was so much going on. When we was going through, I decided – at that point, Jerry, I didn't see no way out, but I knew I wanted to leave something for my kids as a legacy. I knew, I said, I didn't have the money, but I just wanted to leave something. And as you probably heard, that's when I just started doing events in the community. Now this, so for the last 10 years, I've been in the media, because I decided to my kids, I said, look, I don't know if I'm going to have a house to leave y'all when I die, or a lot of money or a car. I don't know what I'm going to have to leave y'all. But if I can leave you all a legacy of service to others, that I've done my job. And so when we was going through, I went to the local businesses and communities, presented myself and said, look, this is what I want to do for other people. And my son came to me in his senior year and said, Mom, you taught us how to give back. So now I want to join the military. That's my way of giving back.
Wow.
But I remember this, he told me when I watched his DVD boot camp, because he didn't work out like the recruiter told him. I said, son, how did you make it through? He said, well, Mom, I thought about you. It was a lot of nights I heard you crying. He said, it was probably the hardest thing I had to do was go through that Marine boot camp. He said, but you could get anything. You're not a bad-looking lady. He said, you could have did anything to go get money, and you didn't. You could start drinking.
Yeah.
You could start doing drugs, but you didn't.
Yeah,
and I said,
right, that's right.
Yeah. That's what he said.
Yeah, that was powerful what he said. Because that's true, because I've seen your pictures on Facebook. You're a very attractive woman. You could have done anything to get the kids out of the street and get into a place and bunked up with some raggedy dude pushing drugs and stuff on your kids. And, you know, you could have gave up. But I guess the will of God was in you, you know, the strength of an angel, and you got out of that. Now let's start over a little bit, and I want to know, you know, how did all this happen? You know, I know you didn't just become homeless right after the sixth kid or the fourth kid. So what happened? What's the beginning of the story?
The interesting part about, I was married for 10 years to this guy, the father of my last two kids. But when we were in our early 20s, and he was an electrician, and I just had a GED and 4 kids. So he was really nice to me in the beginning. But what he did, he tried to start a business on his own. Now, not knowing me, I didn't know I had anything to offer. But running a business came easy for me. And he saw that, so his business came to an end one day. And he said, won't you start a home remodeling business? I didn't know he was trying to be funny. So I was like, for real? You saying I can do something? Because, you know, at this time, I'm like 22, 4 kids. My family was like, honey, you good enough to get you a McDonald's job, call it a day. Mm-hmm. But when he presented to me that I could run a business, I went for it. And within 6 months, you would have thought I'd been running this business, went and got a degree. And the business did very well. My first contract was with Habitat for Humanity. Mm-hmm. But guess what? though it was good, doing well, he started not to like me.
Oh,
and
really?
I say that this time, Jerry, so this is freaking me out. This is, you know, so at this time I have 6 kids because I have 2 kids with him.
Right.
And he started to really, I didn't have good self-confidence, self-esteem, so he started to make me feel bad for doing good.
Mm.
And so the abuse started coming. You know, he was my electrician, so he would go around, make my jaws look bad, make me look bad. And he came to me one day, and he said, you know, I really wasn't expecting you to do as well.
Oh,
and because
wow.
I didn't, yeah, he said, I wasn't expecting you. He said, how do you come into my field and outdo me? How do you know how to run a business? Did you play a trick on me? I said, well, I never told you I was dumb. But, Jerry, I didn't know how to run a business came easy for me, but it did.
Mm.
But he said, if you want to be married, you got to give up the business.
Since
I didn't know who I was and I didn't have low self-esteem, but I tell you this, Jerry, for the first time in my life, I hated who I was and I loved who I was at the same time.
Mm.
Because I finally felt good about me, but I couldn't, that feeling didn't last long because my husband no longer liked me in that light, whether I was doing good or not. And when I gave up the business, after he verbally abused me so bad, I'm thinking I'm just worthless. When he seen I had no more fight in me, he left me. And that's how the homeless began.
Oh, wow. So you was a very successful businesswoman, but he started ruining your name by doing bad jobs. So naturally, you were losing business. Your name was no good, so you couldn't. So you couldn't rebuild after he left.
Well, you know, I don't think I wanted to. I think I was so scared. You got to understand, I didn't even, it's one thing people rejecting you because you don't have kids and you dropped out of school. The family think you're just a black sheep. But I've never been rejected for doing good. So I didn't know how to handle that. I was happy being a housewife. I was happy being his wife. I was happy being a stay-at-home mom. And I was like, I didn't even want this. You told me to do this. And he was just like, all right. He just couldn't handle that I was successful.
Wow. That is crazy. Never heard anything like that before.
Yeah.
So he encouraged you to do it, but then he envied you and was jealous at the same time.
Yes.
Mm. Wow, that was sick. Something happened to him.
Yeah. Yeah. And because I didn't know who I was, you know, I gave up the business. I didn't know who I was. You know, this man just came along, you know, treated me good. And when he said he didn't like, you know, his thing was, I would have felt better if I met you and you was a business owner. Then you came into the relationship 5 years later and you start, I was like, okay.
That's what he said.
Yeah, that's what he said. He said he could have handled a little bit more better if I met him in that position. But I guess he was thinking, yeah, how do you start doing good with me? And maybe he didn't understand. I mean, I had 6 kids. When I started a business, my daughter was 3 months old. But for some reason, running a business came easy for me. I don't know. I was just as shocked as he was, Jerry. I was just as shocked. He was that I had that.
People trust you and like doing business with you, so it just came easy.
Yeah.
I mean, people like to do business with people they like.
Yeah.
I listen to you on the show, and, you know, you're a very likable person, so it's easy, you know, that makes it easier for people to feel comfortable and trust you because business is about loyalty.
Yeah.
Loyalty and trust, that's all you got, you know, person's word. All right, Pastor Ho, we're going to take a music break. That was a very exciting story. I love the way you told it. When we come back, we're going to ask a few more questions, and we're going to talk about this book, okay? All right?
All right.
All right. We're talking to Pastor LaTosha Holden out of Atlanta, Georgia. All right. We're going to talk about what her future is with the church. All right. So here we go. We're going to listen to a piece by my favorite artist. That's right. My favorite artist. Well, one of my favorite artists, Kimberly. And she got this piece called I'm Praying For You. All right, here we go.
Okay.
Oops, I hit the wrong button. Come on now.
a billion people reaching for fame. And an out of order world overrating the game. I'm just trying to tell the truth, but they blind to the proof. And the lies of crazy things that's destroying the youth. Believe in the power that you have inside. You can break my things, but you can't break my pride. I'd rather find the light than sit and die inside. I'd rather fight the war, I never run and hide. Used to think that life ain't have a lesson. Sitting alone, I never thought to count my blessings. Stressing, now I hold the word in my possession. Just another way for me to deal with my depression. See people get caught up in the world of pain. All they do is lose, none of the things to gain. No regrets for the life that's living in shame. Gotta change yourself before you put in the sight of his aim.
Listening to Jerry Royce Live Worldwide Podcast.
Yeah, yeah, you tell them, robot. You listen to Jerry Royce Live Worldwide on PositivePower21.org. Tonight we're talking to Pastor Latasha Holden. She just told an incredible story, but if you missed it, you are in luck. You can listen to us on demand, on Spreaker Radio. Just look for Positive Power 21 or Jerry Royce Live. Or iTunes. That's right, ladies and gentlemen. We're on demand on iTunes. They're running all of our episodes. All of the team, all the podcasts is right there on iTunes. Just type in Jerry Royce Live Worldwide and come right on up. Matter of fact, you just go to Google and you can find us on PositivePower21.org. Also, on demand, all our pages current our shows, and they run them live in a live stream. Not right now, though. Well, maybe it is, depending on when you listen to it. But we appreciate you guys, supporting us, and we appreciate all our partners. That's right, Sector 7 Incorporated, William Benson III, Tanika Joy, Keisha Dreams, Charles Clark and the gang, and David Newby. Don't forget about brand new network. Just hit us called Storm Talk Radio 365 with the Storm herself, Benita Claiborne, and she's building a big cast of podcasters. They're going to be bringing some real spiritual stuff, and I'm hoping they bring our good friend here, Latasha Holden, on board. But I heard Latasha, they're saying, it's too late for me. You can't compete with that West Coast time. I heard you, because I know Kimmy Kim comes on pretty late. I don't blame you there, but I'm sure they'll work it out for you. And also, don't forget about our good friend Kimmy Kim Relations Radio. She's on Blog Talk Radio, and she's streaming live right here on Positive Power. We also have Beverly Fells Jones, and she's supposed to be giving us more shows because we enjoy Beverly so much, and we appreciate her. And Tina Hobson. Tina Hobson, she's bringing us some devotional music now, as well as her Friday Night Throwdown. That's right, where I Am Superwoman 2. That's right. Somebody beat it to Superwoman 1. A young girl got her. But anyway, Superwoman 2, she has an awesome show on Friday nights. Tune in to her live broadcast. You can find her on demand right here on Positive Power. I forgot what channel she is. I think it's channel 16 or 17 between her and Senior Pastor Barmadella DeBello. That's right. He's the prayer warrior. He brings a very powerful prayer. Him and his lovely wife, Pastor Ron DeBello, they bring Bible study. Oh, and don't let me forget to tell you guys this. All right. I was running late tonight because just guess what? I found an awesome Bible study. We're running a live Bible study. I'm about to say bubble study. Bible study from Maximum Life Christian Church in Baltimore, Maryland, right outside of Baltimore. It's about 15 minutes outside of Baltimore. So those of you that's in the Baltimore, Maryland area, Owensville, Randallstown, Piceville, Ricestown, you're looking for a place. You're looking for a place to call your home. Oh, these women are so vibrant, so friendly, so open, and they can teach some Bible study. You got to check out Pastor Sherry Grant. She's live. We had her live tonight on Periscope. So every Wednesday, well, maybe every other Wednesday, depends on my schedule, you can check her out live on Periscope. And I will let you know through our Facebook channel. And also, if you miss it, you can catch it on demand on our YouTube channel and also We also recorded her podcast. That's right. We podcast on Spreaker Radio, so you will be having an opportunity to listen to her live Bible study. And she was bringing it tonight, too. I know she was showing off for the cameras because we had a big boy camera, so we had her on high definition. All right. I wish Latasha Holden was up in this area. We can shoot her for live Bible study, but she's not in the area. But maybe we can get her to Periscope one of her sermons when she get her church up and running. So tell us about this church, Pastor Latasha Holden. You're going to be starting a church. So how soon is this going to happen? When is God going to make this happen?
Well, I'm just looking at different areas now. And I'm just being led. I don't do anything out of time and when God give me to go ahead. He's giving me to go ahead, but I'm just moving with the Spirit. I'm just watching and, you know, just going out looking for, you know, places. Maybe if I start off sharing something with someone, you know, just looking at your options.
That's right. You get to share. That's right. Church sharing. You can start off 8 in the morning before that service gets started, right?
Yes.
Or school. I see people start with schools, you know, auditoriums or wherever they can. They can line up chairs, right? Doesn't matter. It's where you decide to have church at. Yeah, that's going to be exciting. Let us know when you're ready. And even if you decide to start with one person, we'll show you how to broadcast it live for us, okay? So we can check out. I know you got powerful messages inside of you. So we don't care if it's just one person. We're going to work that out, okay? We're
going to
make
right,
sure podcast. Okay? You know we got a lot of people in this thing, and they're waiting to hear you, all right? It's like the night. That's right. So we're going to make sure people can find this show. And when you're ready to, you know, to release your church to the world, let us know. We want to help you out, okay?
All right. Sounds good.
Yeah. Let us sow a seed in Latasha. Did you come up with a name yet? Did God give you a name of your church?
It's Love and Compassion of Jesus Christ Ministries.
Whoa, I never heard that one before. He said Love and Compassion of Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Is that what you said?
Yeah, that's what I said. Yeah, that's it.
Wow, that's a good one. Well, I can't wait to bring that. Let us know when you have your Bible study. Just remember, you don't need nobody there with you. You can just go ahead and Bible study and podcast it. I'll broadcast you, all right?
Okay, thank you.
I'm right here. Positive Power, right here for you.
Right here.
So you let us know when God put on your heart, it's time for you to start podcasting your Bible study. You don't need nobody there. We right here with you. All right? We got people listening to you. All right? Radio Bible study.
Yeah.
All right, I'm so excited. Now you got me all hyped up now. I'm going to be texting you later. When are we going to start our Bible study, Pastor? You're like, that's Jerry. Anyway. All right. I got a question for you. What was you like in middle school and high school, you know, before – you know, the babies came. What was you like? What were you like?
You know, I was always a peacemaker. I mean, I was a quiet kid, and I was just a kid that wanted to be friends with the other kid that was picked on and set by themselves. I don't know. I've always had a sense of, when I was shy, I didn't, my low self-esteem started probably when I was 13, 14. You know, I was just one of those kids that had to be. My love language is words of affirmation. And, you know, if parents don't know that and they, you know. So I didn't get that. I was one of those kids you got to really kind of, I believe in you, you can do it. And anything goes.
You need a cheerleader. So you need a cheerleader?
Yeah, I did. And so I didn't get it. I think that's why I dropped out in 10th grade. I just felt I couldn't, you know, the love of school wasn't just there for me.
Oh, you did that on your own, so it wasn't no circumstances that dropped you out. You just did it on your own.
I was pregnant. I had my first child a week before my 17th birthday, so that didn't help either. Yeah.
Right. So where were moms and pops at when all this was going on in your mind? You know, what was up in the oldest?
I don't know. You know, they're still together. I was raised in a two-parent home, but just find out now after we've talked and they both suffered from low self-esteem. So I don't know, because I was the oldest girl, that it just hit me, you know, that all that just, and I was just that child that needed to really be, like I remember when I was in my book, I tried out for the police department. And when I went to my father, he tried to play mind reverse hustle on me. You ain't going to do it. You ain't going to make it. Okay, but I'm a child that needs words of affirmation. So because he started talking that way, I was like, oh, you don't think I'm going to do it? You know, and I just, right before I went to academy, I just dropped out because I was just one of those kids, you know, needed to be told that I could and everything.
You had your GED at that time?
Yeah, and I think that's why when my ex-husband told me I could start a business, and he was like, well, if you fail, you fail. If you succeed, you succeed. It's up to you. I never was presented with that. So that's why I just like, for real? You think I can do it? Yeah. And so that's why it kind of hurt me a little bad when he turned on me. I'm like, what?
Yeah. So where are you today? You know.
Well, I tell you, by the grace of God, who else to know that he would bring me as of May of last year? I went from a GED to an MBA. And now
wow,
I'm on my
bachelor's.
And I'm just shocked right there, Jerry. I mean, you know, now it's funny. I'm like, okay, I did good in business, and then I end up with an MBA. So it's kind of, okay, that was. So now I'm doing a Master of Divinity, and my second year on that. And I'm just going into the career as a chaplain.
Mm-hmm.
And a book came out this year, my documentary. And so now I'm just going out, you know, speaking and as a community advocate, just speaking for other mothers and kids to say, hey, we got to get this together. You know, so I post a couple
That's
of
right.
videos. Yeah.
Yeah. So they can find your documentary on YouTube?
Yeah, my documentary on YouTube, videos on YouTube of me speaking at community events, at public libraries. And because, yeah, one thing I did, Jerry, and I'm proud of, my kids, to see my six children, I have four grandkids now.
Oh, wow.
But to see my six children, and I didn't have to have run-ins with the law and school and gangs and drugs. I went through, because I was there. I was there to protect them and love them. I would not let the streets raise my children. And I had made that in my mind. If I laid down to have them, that was my responsibility to raise them. And so I'm proud of those six kids. I really am.
That's right. Good for you. Now, you said you got married when you were, you said 17, 18?
No, early 20s.
Early 20s. Okay. So you were married twice?
Yes.
Oh, wow. Okay. So tell us about the first husband. What was he like?
There was the first one, the one I just told you about.
Oh, okay. The first one, the one that encouraged you to go into business.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So the second one. So you married now?
No. Jerry, you know what? Jerry, you're going there. Do you know I've been divorced now? It'll be a year in next month. And you won't
okay,
even believe
right.
it, Jerry.
Hmm.
I said the reason behind that, I'm, you know, and my ex-husband was a minister, a pastor, but see, I didn't know it was a hustle side to that, and he married me because he saw potential, and lo and behold, it didn't happen in 3 months, the way he wanted to happen, he didn't want to be married no more.
Wow.
Yeah, he said, oh, you're the best thing that happened to me. He said, I've never met a woman like you. But because I'm from the streets and it didn't happen the way I wanted it to happen, he did not want to be married. I couldn't believe it. He said, I've never seen nobody like you, man. You're probably one of the best women I ever met in my life. But because his mind is so good where he came from, I'm like, are you serious? So,
So you guys had a church together? You were the first lady?
Yeah, when I met him, he had a little place he was preaching. Yeah, I was the first lady. Yeah.
Wow, you're the first lady.
Yeah, take in mind, he didn't want to leave. But you know what I decided? This is in my book. What I decided was, see, I'm not caught up trying to be first lady. You know, most of my sisters go through so much, so I'm not blown. That don't faze me.
Mm-hmm.
But, Jerry, I decided that I'm 43 now. I had a, you know, it was rough the first half of my life. you know, because I've always either looked up to someone or raised a child. But I decided this time, if somebody didn't want to be with me and they wasn't going to treat me right, I'm not getting abused for nobody, to be with nobody.
Right.
And I want a second half of my life to be who God called me to be, you know. And so that's how the book came and everything. I just said, you know what, brother, if you want to hustle someone else, you can go do that, but I'm not going to be hurt because, no. And
yeah,
and
time to go. Time to
yeah.
go. So I'm free to be me is based off your whole life or just part of your life?
The whole life.
The whole life.
Yep, from 13 until now.
So the book was written to give hope and inspire many to keep pushing despite the odds. And you told us a lot about those odds. So writing this book, was this book kind of therapeutic for you? Did it give you the strength to be the person you are today?
It was therapeutic. But, you know, I think I got tired. You know, sometimes we all have to get to that point where we're sick and tired of being sick and tired. You know, I'm tired on everybody else's opinions. And have you, Jerry, if you really think about it, everybody who probably telling you what you can't do and talking about you and gossiping about you in the family, those will be the main people that ain't doing that with their life. And so I just tried to, you know, if you really think about it, not too many people who's busy going forward in a positive direction, they don't have time to talk about people. It always be the one that's on the sidelines that got something to say because, you know, they. So my book was saying, you know what, I'm giving everybody junk back. I'm going to be free. I make mistakes. God loves me just like you are. You know, God loves you when you make mistakes. And so I'm free to be me and say, whatever you think about me, it's okay. I just have one goal.
Right.
Oh, now, if my God can tell me, well done, thy good and faithful servant, that's all I want to hear. Because at the end of the day, Jared, we can't take none of this stuff with us.
We sure can't. You're right. Natasha, when you start your church, this beautiful church that you're about to start, what can people look forward to when they join? You know, your first five members. What are you hoping from your first five, your fabulous five? Do you see them?
The first five or whoever joins. If you've been rejected, you're hoping, you lost, you gave up, and you just say, you know what, I'm tired. Come on, this family here, no judgment, been there. I know what it feels like. Just come on. We're going to go to the cross together. Now, I'm going to give you what God needs, and I'm going to try my best to help walk you through so you can finish your journey and so you can heal well done, thy good and faithful servant.
Amen. Now, Pastor, you have a very compassionate voice. You know, it really projects over the airways. Can a person become a member from any city, any state, any country, and you still love them the same if they were sitting in your living room or in your church, I forgot what that is called.
You said, but I still love
them. Yeah, the pews. Yeah, you love them.
Oh, the yeah. I, you know what? Because God, you know what, Jerry, my thing is this. God loved me. See, my love comes from knowing. Yeah, people gave up on me, Jerry. I was out for the kids. You know what I'm saying? But God loved me so much, he didn't forget about me. And so my love is vast. I love so unconditionally. Some people think, I'm serious, I've had people, men, women, it's almost like unrealistic, but they don't understand. I understand grace and mercy.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
God discussed out a long time ago with some of the stuff we probably did, but he didn't. So I understand grace and mercy. Now that don't mean I'm down for wrong, because I do believe in order. But I sure understand grace and mercy because God has shown a lot to me.
Amen. Yes. You can, I mean, I've seen some situations of people, you know, in the hood, and they didn't have it as worse as you. At least they had a roof with running water and heat. Air condition. Whew, man. You told a good story. All right. Pastor, we're gonna take a quick break, give everybody a chance to just digest what you just said. And we're gonna listen to another one of my favorite artists, Angel Sessions. She has a song called Jesus Is Coming Soon. I know that's what people will hear a lot from you in your pulpit. It's coming soon. All right, here we go. Angel Sessions. And you can buy this on Amazon also, right next to Pastor Latasha's book, I'm Free to Be Me, available on Kindle. Hold tight, everybody, and thanks for tuning in to Jerry Royce Live Worldwide.
Don't delay giving up. Be strong and lift him up, because he's the power of life.
So lift him up.
Rain away.
Yeah.
Rain away.
Yeah.
Rain away. For this is the last
don't
day.
Don't look to the right, right.
Don't look aside.
Jesus is coming.
Jesus is coming.
Up and up in
Jesus is coming.
Up and up in
don't look to the
left,
right.
Don't look to the right, right.
Don't look aside.
You are listening to Jerry Royce Live Worldwide Podcast.
You can't get through.
listening to Positive Power 21.org with Jerry Royce.
All right. Thank you, family, for bringing me in. That was Merlin Dunn. He'd do it again. And also you heard a short piece from Angel Sessions. I'm in here pushing the wrong buttons. But anyway, we got it done. We're talking to Pastor Latasha Holden. Read and find out about a teenage mother, high school dropout, former homeless woman with six children, went from a GED to an MBA, a woman who felt unloved, unwanted, and rejected. After reading this book, you can join hands with Pastor Latasha, and she continues to press towards the finish line and becoming the woman God created her to be. And we're so excited for her. We can't wait to hear about the success of her church that she's been ordained to start by the hands of God. All right, Pastor, we really appreciate having you on the show. You told a very exciting story. We're so glad that it was a positive story at the end, because we hear about these things all the time. And, of course, you know, the devil's out there trying to tear people apart who has things right now. Some people got a whole lot of stuff out there, blessings. But they just, man, they're just not acting right out there right now. So we got to do what we got to do, right? Yeah. Something about the good one. All right, so you ready to close us out with some positive words and a prayer? We appreciate it.
Yeah. Well, as the song was saying, that God is going to do it again. You know, I know there's so many people saying, well, Pastor, you don't know that I've been crying in the midnight hour. It don't seem like my joy is coming. But God wants me to tell you that your tears and your cries have came to his throne room like a sweet aroma. Although man may have forgotten about you, God has not. And God is going to do it again, but this time he's going to do it better. See, there are some people that just cannot go where God is taking you. So I just want you to know to let go, because those spiritual hitchhikers, those leeches, are only going to drain you at your next destination. God has plans for you. And so I just want to leave everyone on this note. I always tell people this. Don't never allow no one to sit high and look low to judge you. We all have a chapter in our lives we don't want read out loud. Be blessed, and may God be with you. Thank you.
Amen. Amen. So you going to pray for us? You going to end the show in a prayer?
Yes. Yeah.
All right. Appreciate you. Thank you so
Father
much.
Father God, we thank you, oh God, for allowing this opportunity, oh God. I just ask that you bless Brother Gerald, God, and what he's doing. Father God, you using him to open up doors where people can come and share their stories with so many countless others. Father God, we thank you right now for divine favor over his life, over his ministry. And we thank you right now for doing a new thing in your people's lives. Father God, thank you for your mercy and grace. Thank you for letting us know that it's not that we're so special that we're doing everything on our own, but it's only because of your love that we're still here. Thank you, O God, for sending us to another day and bringing us safely, we pray, during this night, that we may arise in the morning, because you may give us a second chance to do what you called us to do and to get things right and set our houses in order. We come to you in your son Jesus' name and say thank you, thank you, thank you, and amen.
Amen. That's right, because he's the truth and the life. Appreciate you, Pastor, for coming here and sharing your story with my audience. I know it's going to bless somebody who's feeling like they have not done enough for their family. But, woo, you've done something. Woo. You got a young man in the military. And what are your other kids doing before we end the show? Where are they at in their life?
Well, my oldest son, he's been in the military now 8 years. I got a daughter. She's 22. She's trained to be a paramedic. I got a daughter that's 21. She's married to a young man in the Marines. And my son is 24. He's trying to get into movie production. And, of course, his youngest two at home.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, good, good. So you have to have him get in contact with Sector 7. They always looking for help. Yeah, Sector 7 Incorporated. Kimmy Kim can hook him up. She's working for them.
Okay.
Yeah.
I forgot about
that. Yeah. How you forget about that?
I know. What happened? She forgot about me, Jerry. She forgot about me.
Yeah, I know. Kim. All right. I tell you, Pastor, I tell people all the time, I say they got to listen to Jerry Royce Live Worldwide on PositivePower21.org. We always have an exciting people, exciting stories, inspirations. You know, it's never going to end on a negative note, because that's why you were here, to spread God's glory, give him praise. Yeah. That's what it's all about. That's why we're here, to help each other, to band together, to hold hands in love, in harmony, be humble, and praise his name. That's what we're supposed to be doing, but they just don't understand. But we'll make it happen, right? One person at a time. I'm Jerry Royce Live. I'm worldwide. Thank you for tuning in to Jerry Royce Live on PositivePower21.org and Spreaker.com/PositivePower21. This is a Royce Enterprises production. And don't forget about replay on Facebook.com/Jerry Royce Live. All right, everybody, thanks for joining us. That's a wrap.